1988 was the first year in pro surfing's brief history that there would be two world champions crowned in less than 9 months. This occurred so that the final leg of the tour could now take place in Hawaii in December to correspond with the calendar year. Going into the final event of the 88 World Tour in Australia, Damien Hardman held a slight lead in the ratings, but for the first time in many years, there were four men still in the race for the title. The 1988 Coca-Cola Classic also decided who would win the woman's crown, and young rookie Pauline Menser from Sydney knocked out the woman's number one contender, Wendy Botha. Another high-placing rookie was Lisa Anderson of Florida. Tom Carroll put on a rock-solid performance and looked certain to give Damien a run for his money. For the first time in 5 years, Tom Curren had no chance of winning the world title, but he is still rated as one of the fiercest competitors in pro surfing. Brad Gerlach was unlucky to have not had a strong fourth wave in this heat, and he lost to Barton Lynch by the narrowest of margins. This heat between Australia's powerful goofy footer Tony Sawyer and California's Kim Merrig was the deciding heat to determine if Wendy Botha would survive to become the new world champion. Kim needed only to win this round and she would have enough points to claim her second world title. In a close split decision, Tony narrowly defeated Kim, and the crown went to Wendy Botha, the first time it's ever been won by a woman who wasn't American. The Coca-Cola Classic is one of professional surfing's oldest events, and it draws your typical Aussie crowd out for a few days of sun and fun. Quarterfinals, everyone had hit their stride, and Barden was looking red hot against the normally undefeatable Tom Carroll. The mushy beach break conditions at North Manly were perfect for Barden, who surfs here regularly.
Once more.
Tom Carroll knew his shot at the 88 title was now over. Curren breezed through his quarterfinal heat against Wollongong's Robbie Page. Elkerton easily outpointed Californian Ted Robinson, and his win meant he was the only one left with a chance at taking the crown away from Damien Hardman. Damien really had his work cut out for him surfing against a blazing Martin Potter. This heat was actually too close to call, especially after Damien had an untimely fall. But Damien came right back and just pipped Potter. Damien's win meant that the world title would be decided in his next round against Gary Elkerton. Which had remained unexciting throughout the early rounds of the event, took a turn for the better on the final morning. The huge crowd that had gathered was treated to 3 to 5 foot clean lines. This year's trials event was an exciting prelude to the semifinals, and Western Australia's Dave McCauley just beat a charging Merrick Davis surfing on his own home turf. Tom Curren and Barton Lynch were the first to duel it out in the first semifinal, and both gave stellar performances. Thank you. Barden's win over Curren guaranteed him third place overall in the 88 ASP rankings. The most important heat of the year between Damien Hardman and Gary Elkerton began with Damien taking an early lead. Gary surfed with his typical fluid style, but it was obvious that Damien had the momentum in his corner. Elkerton kept nipping at his heels, but Damien seemed unbeatable until he fell on two consecutive waves. Suddenly, Elkerton had a chance at narrowing the gap, but it was not to be. His waves simply didn't have enough size. Damien's final two waves were rippers all the way to the beach. After a quick handshake, Damien left the water knowing that he had won his first world title. What better place to go to get away from the crowds and traffic of city life than Indonesia? Bali, which for years was the favorite destination of thousands of traveling surfers, is now becoming a rest stop and launching pad for other more private destinations. Sumbawa, which lies two islands east of Bali, has not been explored very extensively due to its health risks and dangerous coastline. In fact, the people here have rarely seen Western travelers at all. Entering the village of Dampu, we were literally mobbed by hundreds of curious townspeople. Further out in the country, we became seriously bogged when our driver took a wrong turn. 20 minutes later, we broke free and headed over to a fishing village on the Uhu Peninsula. Here we were once again greeted by a ragtag band of small children who followed us everywhere. After catching a boat ride around the peninsula, we caught our first glimpse of why we had come here. Directly out front of our camp was a nice little right-hander, which we called Periscope Point. To our dismay, we had no shelter, no kitchen, and no well water. The camp that we were promised simply didn't exist. For the first few days, we ate fish and drank tea, but it was the waves that sustained us. Australian surfers Brett Hodge and Albie Ross found the waves much to their liking. Shelter was a rare commodity, and filming in the tropical sun was suicidal without a lean-to for protection. On day two at the camp, most of the crew decided to check out some other breaks in the area. But shortly after they left, things were to take a bizarre change for the worse. The weather turned nasty, and we were forced to find what shelter we could from the pouring rain. The villagers, some of whom had hiked 8 miles to watch us surf, crawled under the grass shacks with us, and Darren Hanley kept them amused, pretending to drink coffee through his ears. When the rains finally let up, we were greeted with excellent overhead surf, but unfortunately, it was quite overcast, and all of the pro surfers were still off searching for classic left-handers. Queenslanders Ted Taylor and Peter Morrison were at the right place at the right time, but I was not so lucky. The rain, humidity, and haze were taking their toll on my cameras, and this would be the last roll of movie film I would shoot in Sumbawa. After a brief stop back in Sydney to have my camera repaired, I decided to head out west to visit an old friend, Brian Hughes, a transplanted Californian who now calls Western Australia his home. Mike McCormick, who is the current reigning amateur surf champion here, packed us into his trusty four-wheel drive and showed us some of the spots that make this strip of coastline one of the world's great surfing areas. If anywhere can truly claim the title God's country, it must be the south and west coast of Australia. Surfing alone or with just a few mates, hundreds of miles away from the nearest big city, is the rule, not the exception here. And a four-wheel drive Jeep is a must to discover new breaks. dirt roads go on forever, and during one weekend, we drove nearly 800 miles off-road searching for waves. This right-hand point break, only an hour away from Albany, was showing some potential, so Mike decided to crack it for a solo session, Western Australia style. Once you have touched, you can't forget it. Here, sightings of white pointers are more common than multicolored wetsuits at Newport Beach, but Mike has salt water running through his veins and figures the sharks think he's one of them. Margaret River has a sleepy country atmosphere about it, but the waves are usually overhead and not to be taken lightly. Mike has surfed here all his life, and he passed up a chance to go on the world tour to take a job with his family's business and surf here every weekend. I can't say I blame him. Without a doubt, Mike, who hails from Perth, is definitely Western Australia's top big wave surfer, and he reckons the bigger, the better. Next morning, I headed down south to meet up with some of the young Australian pros on a one-day break from the APSA Tour. The APSA is the Australian equivalent of the PSAA in the United States. You can't help being blown away by the abundance of excellent breaks here and the variety of sea life. The waves this day had a quality about them that all surfers dream of. Teaming up again with Mike for my final day out west, I prayed for an offshore wind. What we found arriving at the beach exceeded even my wildest expectations. We'll be right back. Nothing can possibly describe the fear in the pit of your stomach, getting caught inside and having to paddle out through monster set waves like this. Halfway around the world, the warm water of Puerto Rico seemed the perfect follow-up to chilly Western Australia. So off I flew to check it out. Out the window, I spied the island of San Salvador, which was the first spot discovered by Christopher Columbus in the New World. Puerto Ricans love the beach, and lovely Latin ladies are everywhere. How better to cool off on a hot day than a fresh coconut? Near the city of Rincon, people still surf just for the fun of it, and every day is a party in the warm tropical sun. Even a Rasta hippie feels right at home here. This surf spot is called Domes, and it's right in front of a decommissioned nuclear power plant. This surfer radiating energy is Walter Cerny from Central California, who happened to be visiting Puerto Rico on a promotional tour for his main sponsor. I couldn't help but notice a bit of Dave Parmenter's influence in his style. Is another break just down the road from Domes, and while it looked fun, it was one of the weakest waves I've ever filmed. Even a red-hot young surfer like Chris Brown was having a difficult time finding the flow. So back on the road we went, searching for somewhere with a little more punch. One of the most consistent reef breaks on the island is this spot known as Middles. We'll be right back. The Hawaiian winter of 88-89 won't go down in anyone's books as a classic year, but the smaller than average conditions did produce clean spring-like conditions at classic breaks like Velzyland. This sequence was filmed on various days throughout December and January, and many of the world's top surfers stopped by to sample VLAN's hollow chambers. Ross Clark Jones has made a name for himself charging Big Sunset in Waimea, but he's equally adept at shredding small VLAND. Boogie boarders like Ben Severinsen fit nice and tight in VLAN's smallest barrels. Derek Ho's casual style beautifully complements each wave he rides. Marty Thomas was the most improved ASP surfer of 1988, jumping from 44th all the way to 12th place. Richie Collins put in more time this winter at VLAND than any other pro. Rocky Point was a saving grace this winter for goofy foots from around the world, but nobody surfed it better than these three powerful Hawaiian surfers.
Yeah.
could count the good days at sunset this winter on one hand, and most of them came during the running of the Pro Class Trials and World Cup competitions. Australian Richard Cram came out of retirement and showed he's still a force to be reckoned with. Richard Schmidt loves to charge it when sun sets giant. ASP rookie Matt Branson risked life and limb on his march up the ratings ladder. Leon McNamara didn't make many new friends this winter, but he did tackle Big Sunset with the best of them. One of this year's class acts was young Tahitian surfer Vatea David, better known as Poto. Bobby Owens continues to be a major force on the North Shore year after year. Stays in shape by riding a bicycle, and he steadfastly refuses to drive in cars. His wave judgment and positioning has made him a favorite to the pro judges, and he will most likely join the elite top 30 ranks in the coming year. Queensland's Munga Berry was so stoked with Hawaii this winter that he went back down under and won the 1989 Pepsi Junior Pro, Australia's premier pro-am event. Check out Tony Ray's unintentional layback and excellent recovery in an early heat of World Cup action. David Cantrell was a standout at Pipeline, but this wave at Sunset was absolutely off the Richter. Little surfs Sunset so confidently that you just know that one day soon he'll win a major event here. Richard Marsh from Cronulla put on a gutsy performance for someone best known for his small wave skills. In this heat, Richard defeated both Robbie Bain and Martin Potter. Not an easy task for a goofy footer to pull off. Gary Elkerton sometimes seems to just play with Sunset, but Tom Carroll's relationship is both deep and meaningful. Tom was easily this winter's top dog in Hawaii, any way you look at it, and his performance at Sunset Beach was two notches above the competition. Sean Thompson ended the year firmly in the top 16 for an unprecedented 13 consecutive years. Poto recovered from a horrifying wipeout to catch one of the best waves of the contest. Tom Curren had his work cut out for him against the young Tahitian surfer, and Poto narrowly defeated the former world champ in an exciting four-man heat. Tom Carroll outdistanced the competition to win the first big wave Hawaiian event, thus putting him in the driver's seat towards another world title. This year's Pipe Masters was the non-event of the entire winter, and the only exciting waves occurred on day one during the first few heats. Barton Lynch and Tom Carroll both lost early in the Pipe Masters, leaving the door open for Damien Hardman in the small, sloppy, narrabeen-like conditions. The surf didn't improve much for the Billabong trials, and day after day of windy, rainy conditions forced the early rounds to go off at Aukai Beach Park. Richie Collins, the final event of 1988 was a disappointing conclusion to an otherwise brilliant year. Two of the hottest stars in the Billabong event were youngsters Luke Egan from Newcastle, Australia, and Florida's Todd Holland. Poto continued his assault on the top 16 pros, narrowly losing to Martin Potter in the first round of the main event. Sonny Garcia charged everything in sight with a near suicidal intensity. The morning of January 2nd, 1989, was to become the most memorable day of the entire winter. The Billabong Pro had been rapidly running out of time, but luckily a solid west swell arrived, and Tom Carroll wasted no time tearing into it. Noah Budrow gave Pipeline his best shot, but Tom was definitely in control of the situation. It almost seemed predestined watching this first morning heat that Tom would come out on top. Second heat, Todd Holland took some wild drops and easily outpointed a cautious Mike Parsons. Caught two of the best waves of the day, back-to-back, to easily outclass Brad Gerlach. Egan pulled off classic Lopez disappearance acts time and time again, earning him the nickname Cool Hand Luke. Mark Occhialupo was the first rider in his crucial heat against Damien Hardman. Damien watched his world title hopes shatter on this wave and Aki breeze to victory. Barton Lynch quickly established priority against Sonny Garcia, and the young Hawaiian saw his big chance destroyed by a paddling interference call. Without a doubt, this was one of the great heats in surfing's history, with both men pulling out all the stops. The clash between Martin Potter and Tom Curren has been called the Surf Maniacs Duel of the Decade. Somehow this seems to describe the mood perfectly. On one of his best waves, Potter, in full pig dog stance, caught a rail, and this one slight error made all the difference as Tom Curren advanced. Carroll's second round matchup against Todd Holland, Carroll seemed slightly out of sync, while the youngster rampaged with reckless abandon on everything that moved. Holland took a lot of severe wipeouts, but he held his own against his mighty opponent. Unexplainably, Carroll made the monumental error of paddling for a wave without priority, and like so many others before him, fell victim to an interference call. Suddenly, the world title was there for Barden to claim if he could just make it through two more rounds. The duel between Curren and Lynch brought the crowd to its feet, but Tom seemed to have used up too much of his energy in his match against Potter earlier in the day. Barton easily advanced through one more important round. Todd Holland's magic run finally came to an abrupt halt when he tangled with a streaking Mr. X. You look like me. Kiss you on the mouth, behind your back, the dirty on you. can't you see? The dude with the dagger, baby, looks like me. Nothing changed. Luke Egan surfed beautifully to unseat Derek Ho, but Derek's quarterfinal finish enabled him to claim his third Hawaiian Triple Crown title. And suddenly it was nail-biting time, Barton Lynch versus Glen Winton. And with the world title on the line, Barton did just what he needed to clinch the title that had eluded him too often before. The greatest thing about Barton's victory was that he earned it the old-fashioned way. He simply cast off his fears and let the champion within emerge. Congratulations, mate. Remember, the ocean is not a renewable commodity. Treat her with respect, and for goodness sake, keep surfing.